our St. Paul community last night experienced one of the most heartbreaking incidents in any of our memory. To have in one incident, a mass shooting right here in our hometown, to have in one incident, 15 people struck by gunfire, to have in one incident, a young life lost in the way that that occurred last night is heartbreaking and traumatic, and just another reminder of how critical it is that we continue to shift our public safety strategies, that we continue to employ the comprehensive, coordinated, data-driven approach that we've brought. I'd like to just thank all of those Good Samaritans who were at the scene, who helped one another, the people who were in those spaces, the officers who, thanks to an infusion of resources that we've been able to employ alongside our St. Paul Police Department to ensure nearly $1 million in police overtime right in that area. Our officers were able to respond immediately, and we're pleased and appreciative of their service as well. We are, of course, heartened to see arrests made in the case, but we know our entire city is going to be listening closely as we demand many, many more answers for what occurred last night, for the heartbreaking trauma that played out across our community last night. And as we continue to press beyond any one of these horrific incidents that we know we've experienced too much of in St. Paul and Minnesota and around the country and in the world, particularly over the last year, about how we continue to press toward a public safety system and toward a community that we don't have to rehearse, and towards state and federal gun laws that keep us from having to rehearse these lines, this trauma, this heartache, over and over and over again.
Have you been able to connect with any of the victims?
I haven't been able to connect directly with the victims. I've left a message for families, but haven't been able to connect directly, fully understand. This is, I'm sure, a full day.
What are some discussions you're having with your team, with your police department, maybe Sheriff Fletcher, regarding getting ahead of this and trying to prevent it from, you know, happening again? I mean, this summer has been terrible. Any discussions like that, or what?
This summer has been really, really hard. As we've seen this national increase in gun violence strike really close to home here in St. Paul over and over and over again, it's been really, really hard. We've got one of our largest police academies in department history on deck right now. We, like I said, have already authorized $1 million in police overtime specific to that area right there. But one of the things that we're seeing is that our police officers cannot do this alone. This is about a community effort. That's why we say we have to invest in people in new ways. We have to invest in areas in new ways and continue to push the ball on this expansive, coordinated approach to public safety. I know, and we're seeing it all over Twitter and all over social media, there are a whole lot of people. There's no shortage of people who can't wait to use what happened last night to make whatever political points they woke up this morning wanting to make anyways. We are a better community than that, and we can use this to double our resolve, to strengthen our data-driven efforts, to strengthen our approaches, which include police officers and community-based approaches to prevent incidents like these from happening again.
With the wild season's going to be starting, do you have any plans to bolster any kind of security in that specific neighborhood where that gets so busy?
We already have, again. I think about a month ago or so, our council approved about $1 million in police overtime and American Rescue Plan dollars to fund police overtime specific to that area to help address an increase that we're seeing in kind of quality of life type of issues in that specific area. So we've already done that, and we'll definitely continue to employ that increase. I think any of those investigatory type of questions should be directed to the police department's PIO. Please.
Hey, Mayor, the sheriff had mentioned even the night before that he was concerned about that area. Were you in conversations with him or your police department about that area in particular over this weekend?
Not the sheriff. Obviously, the sheriff is a law enforcement officer himself who runs a law enforcement agency. And so I'd welcome him if he's got some specific concerns to help be a part of the problem, as opposed to some of the tactics that I think the sheriff has traditionally tried to employ. This is about, but like I said, we have been in very close contact with our police department, with our police chief, with our officers, with the community members, with business leaders in that area regarding that area, which is why we approved the $1 million in police overtime for that specific area. Those officers have been working very closely with community members, and I'm sure will continue to beyond this moment. There are no such plans in place right now or in process.
You mentioned some new officers. Is that happening? Some cadets, or what can you share about that? Sheriff Fletcher mentioned you're receiving some new officers this week. They're getting sworn in.
We have a police academy that's starting. It's one of the largest police academies in city history. We have employed all-in approach to public safety that includes ensuring that our officers have the capacity and the credibility and community that they need to do their job well, working alongside a whole host of community-based responders, people, individuals, interveners in our community who work with us to do things like help prevent retribution and kind of reactive shootings from happening once one has happened, because we know that that can be something that can really domino and can skyrocket out of hand. So those working in combination with each other are at the centerpiece of our strategy that we've employed. Our police department is at the center of those, and we've been able to build a practice of working in very close partnership with one another.
Do you have enough officers?
We have significant needs for investment across the city. We have needs for investment in police officers. We have needs for investment in a host of other things. Our police department is in the budget I have proposed in front of the city council by far, has significant investments above any other city department. We of course have other investments that we have to make as well as a part of our balanced kind of strategy of building a city. But yes, we have a significant number of officers. We have officers who are committed to this city, and as they showed last night, are capable of not only showing up right away, but engaging people, showing a deep level of care to our community, and getting suspects in custody very quickly. What we know is building a safe community requires something to happen way before any of that, and that's why all these types of community types of initiatives and interventions that we keep talking about are so important.
Mayor, do you know why the chief doesn't have any availability today?
I don't.
What resources?
Go ahead.
What resources will the city provide to the families once we make contact, the families of the victims?
And I specifically have not spoken to those families of the victims yet. I know that our kind of those community-based kind of interveners, those kind of supports, reach out immediately in cases like this. And so between kind of the victim support services that we have, that we operate in partnership with the county, those will be, I think, very important. Some of the trauma kind of care type of supports that we have, and also our Healing Streets partnership, which is through our public health department that helps people process grief and trauma in ways that are hopefully constructive for community. The reason we're so shocked and appalled and heartbroken anytime something like this happens is because we're not used to things like this happening in our city, and because we don't accept things like this happening in our city. And that's why our police officers show up as quickly as they do. That's why we take it as personally as we do. That's why our police department is one of the best in the nation, in the world, in ensuring that when shots are fired in our community, when lives are lost in our community, that someone is held accountable for those actions. That's really critical, and that's really absolutely important for us. We know that we have more work to do. We know that our officers cannot do it alone. I'm blessed to live in and serve a city where people look out for one another. We have to continue to do that work on the street level, on the neighborhood level, ensuring that sort of if you see something, say something. We have so many lives that have been impacted, that have been lost, that have been changed forever because someone pulled the trigger or had access to a gun who really shouldn't have. And so that work for us includes ensuring that our police department has the capacity and capabilities that they need to help respond when emergencies happen. That work for us includes the conversation with the grandmothers and the moms and the aunts and the dads and the friends to say, listen, if somebody's playing with a gun and you know that somebody has a gun that should not have a gun, that we need to make sure that we're taking action together as a community to get those guns on the street, off of the street. And that action hopefully one day will include action at the state legislature that would engage, frankly, some of the lawmakers who are hoping to troll St. Paul today, but are literally the hurdles that are blocking us from being able to pass the type of sensible gun control reforms that Minnesotans and Americans want to see happen. That's part of our goal as well. We need to be doing all of the things at the same time, and that's our plan moving forward.
Is the police department looking for any more suspects?
That's a question for the police department. I don't know the answer to that question.
Do you have any of the victims are out of the hospital and the ones who are still in, what their conditions are?
I don't have that information. I'm sorry.
Mayor, can you tell us anything about the relationship between, you know, we know that this bar had security of some kind. Is there any kind of relationship between security at your entertainment spots and your police departments?
I can't speak specifically to the specifics of this bar. One of the things that we're doing through our St. Paul Downtown Alliance has been building this kind of fusion center and the capacity for our police department, building security all throughout downtown to work seamlessly with one another. And so I can't speak specifically to how closely this specific establishment is to that work, but this is certainly a part of this comprehensive public safety strategy that we've employed in St. Paul.
What about areas that aren't downtown? I live on 501 Blair, or 521 Blair, and there was a shooting right outside my house last night after the incident down here. My son and I had to hit the floor and call 911.
I've experienced that as well, and that's why this strategy that we're laying out is the citywide strategy that we're saying we need to continue to employ, that we need to continue to expand citywide. We've seen promising results. We've seen promising kind of results downtown that, you know, some of you have reported on just in the last couple of weeks. We need to continue to expand those efforts, to continue to push those efforts both downtown but also expand them citywide to neighborhoods like yours and all of our neighborhoods in our city. Thank you all very much for being here.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.